Hi, my name is Wouter Emery and I'm the founder of AirShaper. In this second video in our series on how wind tunnels work, we'll be looking at the huge variations in terms of size, cost and velocity of low-speed aerodynamic wind tunnels. Now, the reason for these variations are the changes in object size, object velocity and required accuracy. Let's start with object size. When you place an object in the test section of a wind tunnel, the air needs to curve around it and fit between the object and the walls of the wind tunnel. Now, this creates two problems. First, the blockage ratio. When you place an object inside the test section, you partially block the cross section through which the air can flow. This means that it will locally need to speed up compared to the reference velocity of the wind tunnel, which is typically set and measured at the undisturbed beginning of the test section using a pitot tube. So if you set the tunnel to 10 meters per second, the flow might be going at 11 meters per second around your object. Now, to compensate for this, you can calculate the blockage factor, which is the ratio between the frontal surface area of your object divided by the cross-sectional area of the test section. Using this blockage factor, you can calculate the local flow velocity and correct the pressure and forces. The recommendations will vary, but depending on the source, you will see recommendations to keep this blockage factor below 5-10% to still obtain reliable results. The second problem is the effect of the walls. As the air slides across the surface of the walls of the tunnel, a boundary layer of slower moving air will build up. Now, in many applications, this slower moving air would not be present in reality and can thus bias the results. Also, the walls can interfere with the flow and pressure patterns around the object if they're too close. In that regard, it can be very interesting to first run a CFD simulation to analyze exactly how large this disturbed flow and velocity pattern around the object is, to know how far it should be from the walls. One example of this are the vortex structures around the wingtips of a drone or a plane. In some cases, you'll even see wind tunnels employing an open test section, partially to overcome some of the challenges posed by the blockage factor and the effect of the walls. Another aspect is the velocity. A cyclist may be going at 10 meters per second, a race car at 100, and an airplane at 250. So ideally, you select a wind tunnel that can provide you with the wind speed that you need. In reality, however, it will usually not be possible to test your application at full size at full speed, mainly because of two reasons. First of all, the budget. Large and or high-speed wind tunnels are very expensive to build or rent. And secondly, availability. Apart from the fact that they're usually overbooked, the wind tunnels, they may simply not exist for the size and or velocity that you need, like for large airplanes. In those cases, you can work with scaled models. But keep in mind that in order to achieve the same flow pattern, you need to match several similarity numbers. The most important one is the Reynolds number. Now, if you don't know what the Reynolds number is, check our separate video on our channel on that topic. If you want to keep the Reynolds number the same when scaling down your application, it basically comes down to the fact that if you scale down the object size by a factor x, you actually need to scale up the wind speed by the same factor x. And this can make you hit the speed limit of the wind tunnel again, or, even more impressive, hit the limits of incompressible flow, which is around Mach 0.3. So, working with scaled models is also a delicate balance. And finally, there's the required accuracy for your application and wind tunnel campaign. The higher the flow quality needs to be, or the more realistic you want your setup to be, the more tricks you need to pull. Like controlling the temperature of the air inside the tunnel using a large cooling system, applying a moving floor underneath the car to mimic real road conditions, or even to work with gases different than air to obtain better similarity numbers. Now, as you can imagine, this can quickly make the cost of the wind tunnel skyrocket. So that was it for the second video in our series on how wind tunnels work. I hope you liked the insights into huge variations in size, cost and velocity for low-speed aerodynamic wind tunnels, and hope that you stay tuned for more, because there's more coming up. If you liked the video, please click the like button, and thanks for dropping interesting comments. Thanks for watching, see you soon, bye bye!